Busting Room series that you can afford. Yesterday we talked about place, about the choices writers make about locations within the art of the play, and today we extend that conversation into space, into the which I suppose is a slightly more practical way of thinking about playwriting. There's a lovely broad ambiguity to the headings of these sessions, and there's any number of ways that we can take the conversation. Writing space can refer to the physical places, the environments, how we actually make work for spaces, but it can also refer to your writing space, the space in which you do your playwriting, and hopefully we'll have time to touch on both of them. Can I introduce this extraordinary panel of brilliant theatre makers, Ninna Tersman, who, for those of you who haven't met Ninna, is a Swedish playwright and dramaturg who is, with all of the wisdom and foresight of the European funding models, being allowed to kind of bum around in Australia for many, many months, being brilliant and showing far more interest in Australian theatre than perhaps any artist I've come across from a non-English speaking background. Yeah, I think so. Two phenomenal Australian playwrights, Angela Betzien and John Romeril.
No introduction
needed. I'm going to throw this out to all of you to start, and please, as I say, at any point chip in. But how much, as a playwright, are you thinking about actors in space performing your play as you're writing it?
If I can kick off,
yeah,
probably the smartest thing I ever said. I remembered it yesterday. Is that in the theatre, we carve space and we sculpt time. And that's kind of how I, in a way, summarised my practice, or kind of reached a point where I thought, hang on, that's what we do. We take the space, we enter a space. Our motion, our locomotion through that space is carving that space, and meanwhile time is being sculpted and is beginning to add up to the statue that we walk away with at the end of the show to reconsider and assess. That's a thought.
Soft.
Right. See you in the tech. That's extraordinary. So what does that mean practically? How do you do that?
Over.
No, you have to answer that.
How do you do it? Well, I mean it's just a part of subconscious practice in a way. Huh? I mean, time passes in a show. There are two sorts of time that pass in the show, the 8 o'clock to, you know, 10 to 10 or whatever it is. But there's also story time, where that show moves to in time. How that time is spent. Is it fast time? There's tempos of time. We as writers...
Don't turn up tomorrow, because I'll say this then.
No, I won't. I'll leave you the big T. But control of those things and response to space, what's occurring in the space, bears on how the show goes that night. Quality of audience attention, laughs in the right or wrong place, etc., etc. There are all ways of measuring how well you're going. The theatre, however static and stuck in a space writing and fucking thing you are, it's ultimately a place where people pass time. Sorry, Pete. It's a space where they go to pass time. And of course, space bears down. One of the ghosts in the room that I brought with me today is Yanis Belotis, who
again.
Did again.
We talked about Too Young for Ghosts yesterday.
Oh, sorry.
But go.
Dramatic Principles, a Questionnaire. It's quite 5 pages or something. Point one. Subject, content, theme. And in Belotis Latvian fashion said, what's it about? Point two, propaganda message. What's it saying? Three, time and place. When and where is it set? Four, why is it set there? How does the decision affect the theme? Or expand on it, expose it, etc.
So my question within that...
Yeah. 20 cents,
We've got copies of this in the playwrights in the office if anyone wants it. Those are kind of artistic choices that you're making as a writer. What, Ange, is the relationship then for the space itself as you're juggling those elements of the play that you're going to write?
I was going to say something else, actually.
Okay.
That's
a conversation.
No, I was just going to say that when you start out as a writer, one of the biggest crimes you're told that you might commit as a playwright is to write filmically. And you know that kind of it looms large in your imagination when you're kind of finding how to be a writer. And when I went to the Royal Court and sort of helped out at the Young Writers Program for a couple of years in 2001, I shared this dingy little office with Simon Stevens, and he read a play of mine which was in its very early stages. It was it was set in a car, three kids, about poverty, childhood poverty. And he said, he asked me this question of, he said, when you're seeing the play in your head, are you seeing it as a film, or are you seeing it on a stage in space, in a theatrical space? And, you know, I said, well, no, I'm seeing it on a stage. And we sort of had this kind of tussle around, you know, I think for him at that time in his, about to diss Simon Stevens, but at that time in his career, he was very much into kind of realism. His play Herons was on up in the German space upstairs, and he was very much into having a 13-year-old actor play a 13-year-old character. And my interest was much more in this, in kind of, you know, I thought an adult could play a 9-year-old or an 11-year-old, and we didn't need a car in that space in order to create that world. And so I think, yeah, you need, if you're going to write a play, you need to think theatrically, but I think you can have filmic ideas.
Mm-hmm. 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 You can just leave it up to the director, though.
Yeah.
So that's kind of one of the. But that is a really good point. So what's your, as a playwright, what's your?
Narrow the options in which a director can squirm.
For the writers in the room, all of you, how much are you trying to channel a director's and a designer's approach to the work as you're writing?
Contextual for this.
So
it changes depending on what the project is.
Yep. Yeah. Do you always have a picture?
It depends on, you know, where you start. If you, not very often am I in a dialogue with a director once I start writing. It's more, I have a commission from a theatre, but I might not be in touch. They might not even have chosen a director yet. So it's usually sort of up to me, and then I discuss with the dramaturg at the theatre. So, for me, not so much during, you know, the writing process, more after. You know, I could be in contact with the director during the rehearsals. Mm-hmm. And that would affect writing, depending on, I think, the director has the idea.
Right.
Do you have long track with certain directors and dramaturgs, especially being a dramaturg yourself, as well as a playwright?
Okay, so should I answer this as a playwright or as a dramaturg?
Both.
Okay. Well, I work at the National Touring Theatre in Sweden, where we are four dramaturgs who work full time. And
let's just have a minute.
But yeah, we tend to have longer relationships, both with playwrights and with directors. Also try to, you know, pick new playwrights and new directors to sort of, yeah, to work with them. And as a playwright, of course, I tend to work with directors that I, you know, that we work well together.
So,
right.
Yeah.
To me, that's it.
Yeah, sorry.
Okay.
I just think I'm always excited by what a director and or a designer are going to bring. That's what they do. And so they're really, you know, you're the starting point. You might have, you know, a whole raft of ideas, but it doesn't really take off until those other artists start to become part of it. But then, you know, I don't attempt to design. I think one of the great things is seeing how someone else reimagines your ideas in three-dimensional form. Mm. It's incredibly exciting.
Mm. Depending on the nervousness or paranoia as well.
Well, in many ways, sort of, a script is like a job description for others. And I sort of learned that really intensely because at the Pram Factory and also at La Mama, because I was a wannabe doing acting sort of things with everyone else, and we were just hanging around and getting it on and all that sort of stuff. But in the end, it meant culpability, a sort of moral responsibility for the quality of the jobs that you create or construct a blueprint for. If that building's going to fall down, you ain't much of an architect. If you've never made the concrete footings, what kind of a builder are you? You know, learn cement, learn putty, learn glazing. I mean, it's a trade.
So your responsibility is to give them the very best chance to do the thing.
It's an odd responsibility because you don't want people to work unsafely. So it's a work safe process. But we're in the business of a stretch of embracing and encountering and generating danger. And it's like working for an acrobat or something, really. Actors take chances. They take them in front of fucking people, big mobs. And if you haven't got any empathy for that circumstance, chances are you're going to write a load of me-ism that doesn't serve to allow them to work safely whilst pursuing a dangerous occupation.
Thank you. Did you?
Yeah, I just wanted to say, I guess it depends on what kind of writer you are and the style. And for me, my little personal experience has been that if the place is a character within itself, and you need to respect that, and if there's a lot of it, really depends on what kind of play you're actually writing. I think it's important that you don't leave it to chance that someone is going to get the wrong idea of what your intent is. Because everything, like you're saying, has to tie in together. You're creating a template, as you said. I mean, a computer programmer would never sort of haphazardly design something expecting somebody else is going to put in something to accommodate for something. And you don't want anyone reimagining what you've written. Otherwise, then where's the authenticity in your story? That's maybe how I feel. Maybe I'm a control freak or what. That's for me. You know, obviously the vision comes from yourself. And everybody else who comes into it is basically, from you know, my understanding is that they're supporting that vision. A director directs a play because they believe in that story and they want to see that
story.
Can I
cut in on it just for a second? What Sally was saying is really interesting in the way you're sitting is that as you are part of a collaborative process rather than, and you might initiate it, it may easily, you can transcend your vision by having the input of a director and a designer. And I've seen situations where my whole world has changed how I teach playwriting because of, you know, iconoclastic young people who come in and use the space effectively. So rather than reflecting the world as you see it a la film, they say, oh, this space should be the emotional center of the play rather than a scene for it or a setting for it. And, you know, dealing with space that way is really quite interesting.
Mm. Yeah, so is that something that you that enters your thoughts as you're writing that?
Yes.
How?
I can't think of a specific.
Right.
FJ Holman, you're in a car, you're doing that on purpose. That's part of the space.
Sure.
I'm in an Mortido. And Dark Room. You know, that room in Dark Room is, you know, amazing because, you know, transcends time. It's a space that inhabits three, four different realities at once.
Yeah.
Yes, I do it.
Just going on from that conversation, I'm a baby writer, and I don't when I write, I don't see the image. I hear the voices, and then I'll get a flash of an image. So for me, the space is the emotional space that I'm trying to create. And I just wanted to know what the other writers in the room, because I felt like, am I doing it right? Should I see that? You know, and I'm just wondering what other people...
Yeah, I'm exactly the same. I just hear voices. I don't see anything. And then, unfortunately, sometimes I tend to work with a stage designer very early on, and then we sort of create the room together. It's fantastic, and that really influences the writing. I'm thinking about a production I made 2 years ago about Sami people. I worked with a stage director, and she said, all I know to start with is that it's going to snow the whole time. It's going to snow. I don't know how I will do it or make it, but that influenced the writing immensely.
Is that unusual in Sweden for a playwright to collaborate with a designer early on?
Yeah. Depends on what kind of theatres. I mean, no, and what theatres, I guess.
I love that. I don't think we do that in this country.
I agree.
Yeah, I agree.
And, you know, I'm a closet designer. I will design my own design for the play that I'm writing. It would be terrible, but it has, you know, you have to have some kind of, but if, I think that if from a first or second draft, if a playwright were put with a designer who intimately knows space, in particular, you know, Belvoir upstairs or whatever, they kind of know the nuts and the bolts of it and the mortar of it. That, I think, because I don't think playwrights in this country really hang out in theatres that much, do you know? And so that's fascinating. I love that.
It's really great because it opens up your own thinking.
And then the director comes on board and sort of, you know, plays within that space.
Yeah, even at that stage. I mean, the best process is when you all start together and you have this joint idea and you discuss it, and then you get all of those different ideas and thoughts and pictures from the others, images, and then you can go home and write. Mm. That's what I really love. Yeah.
Isn't there also like different stories for different spaces?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Like if you're being commissioned for, you know, like 50 or 100 seat theatre, or if you're making a large scale spectacle service work, like you write differently with space in mind, and you also, certain stories fit certain kinds of spaces. Mm. Which I think is really interesting.
So that's one of the big things that we're going to move on to as a good place. I'm fascinated by the relationship between writing and architecture and what plays work in what kind of environments. What's your experience as a woman, as the panel, for how you create the work to fit the very specific place that it's going into?
Should I go?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm currently working on a play that I began in 1991. In 1991, I visited a great actor called Jack Charles in jail. It was the jail in my town, Castlemaine. And I was mug enough to say, what's going on? And he told me this great story about how yesterday they took a bunch of prisoners out to lay some egg pipes and so on and clean up a local cricket ground, cut the thistles and all that. And I said, oh yeah, right, okay, community service. And the vuckers forgot to pick them up. And I thought, well, as an opening premise. And I started to work on that show so that I could put it to Jack, so that when he came out, he at least had a play to go to or something. And I did that. It's been a sleeper ever since, but it's waking this year, March 30th to the 22nd. And it's sited in the old Castlemaine jail. And poor old Jack, of course, he's, I've been in that cell. It's a bit spooky, John. but we've got the exercise yard out there, It's a Quaker design, pantechnicon, so that you have a central kind of waters section and you can look along all the rows, much like, say, the Melbourne Public Library or something. Make sure they don't thieve books or get out. And now, here I'm writing a show for... like, I took the plot to next stop, they have to walk back into fucking town, you know. No. And night's falling, and they knock on the door of the prison, ring the fucking bell, no answer. Down below in Castlemaine, there's a rail yard, and certain times of the year, they sort of load a lot of wheat, take it to Melbourne and stuff. One of these prisoners, the white guy, says to Jekyll, train. And yeah, they take off, they go through. So here we are performing a play inside a jail that is about two prisoners who take off and in the course of a long weekend get out of Victoria, get into New South Wales, Coonabarabran first, then Lismore, and finally Jack goes to visit his mate at the Pink Poodle because it's sort of, he's running a motel up there in Surface. And so on and so forth. So it's like that's the time. It's a long weekend. I called it a comic road movie of a play. I've cut that and just listen. It's a comedy. It's a comedy era. I think it's Romeril. It's got to be serious. And comedy. And the reason I don't write much comedy is it's so bloody hard. One of the highest art forms or theatrical forms going. But that is an example of. Here's a show in a space, a jail space, audience enters by entering a jail and already is starting to experience what it must be like to be a prisoner.
So my question is, would you write it any differently if you were putting it in a traditional performance space?
I think I don't care, and it can be staged in multiple places, and several of my plays have had that rather delicious fate. But The theatre that for my sins I've mostly been associated with has always been a bit bed and a bit out there or something, and it's been rare for me to be in a main house. Whilst I know about Italian fucking sliding stuff, whilst I know like the way Strand Electrics created Death of a Salesman. How? 1949, they were able to do dimmers and had created certain lamps that could isolate a space. And Miller knew that electrics was on the move. And he sought to exploit it by having memory scenes in a little kind of shaft of light and so on. Now, Shakespeare probably did that with a candle. And plays were performed in the afternoon. I've got that hassle in the show that I'm referring to. There's going to be a sunset just as a night scene is about to occur. So
I think there's a challenge though, because I think that, you know, to sort of bring some things together, you know, as the impulse dramaturgically for a play for me is to make that play the most honest and interesting version of whatever it intends to be that filled with 30 people and set in a giant bubble, or, you know, and I think directorially it tends to be about that violence of decision making and that kind of practicality. You can wear all those different hats and you can make those decisions, but there is a real danger that you end up writing very specifically for a commission or for an award or for a space.
Why is that a danger?
I think because it tends to immediately shut down the potentiality of the work itself, if the work is from its inception being designed for, you know, and obviously maybe commissions and things like that are different, but if you're genuinely starting sort of speculative work, I think there is a risk that can be mitigated or ignored, but there is an awareness you have to have about going, well, what are we actually talking about when we're writing for space? Is it a provocation of joy, which is great, it's amazing site-specific work and we can make a work that lives there, or are we sort of slowly just clipping the edges of what the piece can be or might be because we're talking about practicalities.
Or are you totally... Sorry, go on.
I was going to say, can I ask though, I mean, you said site-specific. Don't you think... I mean, I think people might work, you know, with spaces in mind, but every single work is going to take place in a site. So
absolutely, but I suppose when in that process do you start making those decisions? Mm-hmm. So there can be a joy in writing for unknown, writing known place, and there can also be a kind of...
I always write knowing that the aliens might come and might want to put my work on.
Yeah.
Why does having created that play with the lawyer in mind, or with Belvoir downstairs, or with Jute in mind, limit the potentiality?
It doesn't always, but there is a... I encounter it a lot, I suppose, in working with new writing, because we don't have a building. So work comes to us at KA with no space in mind, and sometimes that's really thrilling.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes you are talking to a playwright, encouraging them to maybe unpick some decisions they've made that were about these imagined practicalities they had to. You find out they once had a fourth character or a fifth character, because four is big these days, or, yeah. You know, and so that, I suppose that's what I mean. I encounter that a lot where, of course, we're all aiming for supported stages, and of course we're all aiming for the actual theatrical spaces, but the work that we tend to encounter is, you know, a play that comes to you set in an ice cream van or set in a, you know, and I enjoy that process in writing. I encourage writers to think like that.
You crossed it out right now.
Yeah. It's you.
Sorry, 1 second.
No. I find the opposite, because I make work. I don't actually write it down until it's made, and then I write it down. But and so my process is a bit different to being in a room and writing. But I tend to go to the space that I know it will be performed first. And actually, I find that, for me anyway, the limitation is the inspiration.
I absolutely agree. But I suppose what I'm saying is that I think there is a risk of a kind of an attrition at work in big ideas and big plays that happens because we might be fundamentally aiming for a finite amount of space and a finite amount of resources.
Sure. I think it's more a conversation about resources and more constant. Yeah. We'll definitely want to think it's about.
Talking about form, like, I mean, you know, I think storytelling is always free and imaginary, and any story can be told anywhere. I'm not arguing that at all. Like, I think it's interesting though about the craft then is where we craft the story and into what's so a solo or a whatever it is, it's gonna tell a certain kind of story, and we'll make a story for that form. Or that's the flexibility. We've got infinite flexibility. But if you are making I keep referring to circus, but or puppetry or whatever it is, then the space and the form will dictate the way you frame that story.
Do you think it works the other way too, Sally? So that the space determines the form as well?
Yeah, it's like the kinds of stories that you can tell in certain kinds of forms too.
Yes. Oh, it's not like a simple proposition.
Yeah, no.
No, I was just thinking, since where I work at the National Touring Theatre, we have the stages are all over the country where we tour, and some are very, very small, and they're very limited, and so it wouldn't be possible for us to commission a play with more than three actors, and that's not only due to economical reasons, it's just because they're so small, they would be really full if you had more than three actors. And
crowd scene.
Yeah, but I don't think usually writers don't find that limiting. It's just you can also be very creative in, you know, you have three actors and have a very small space. It doesn't necessarily mean that the story will be limited. You can expand in your imagination.
Historically, that's space has created in the Western tradition of theatre, created the form itself. So probably the biggest example that I know of is that the English playhouse tradition was based on class. So the best seats in the house were the boxes where royalty and nobility would sit, then the stalls, the upper classes would sit, the middle classes would sit in the circles, and the plebs would sit in benches in the balconies. When America is created as the great classless society, they banish this class-ridden model and only have a stalls in a circle, which means to get the same amount of people into the theatre, instead of having a very long, high, thin high rows. You end up with very long rows of seats to get the same capacity in, which leads to a very wide stage, which leads to the evolution of a form that will fit that stage, hence the birth of the chorus line and the musical as we know it.
I'd argue that in Australia too, surprisingly, but you know, I think the original Nimrod up in King's Cross determined how Belvoir was shaped, which also determined how the theatre in the Arts Centre in Victoria was shaped too, because of that putting it into the in the end corner. And I think that kind of, you know, showed, you know, that the space was important, you know, that this was a safe space to be in because, you know, they kept on using it. I don't know why. Some sort of psychological reason, I'm sure.
Those people are...
I think it's about resources because, by limiting flies, etc., then you're asking the playwright really to do the heavy lifting in terms of transforming place and time and space, and you're asking the director to invest in that. You're not relying so heavily on the magic of theatre and the spectacle of theatre. You're coming back and asking the audience to use their imagination.
Well, exactly. And go on that. Not a spectator.
That's right. That's right.
Mind you, I think the actual decision in Melbourne had more to do with the amount of seats you could fit around it rather than anything else.
Well, the Fairfax used to be modular, just like the...
Yes, I know.
It'd be interesting just to kind of unpick just for a second those of us who've worked in different spaces around Australia. What kind of writing works well in what kind of space, particularly those companies that might have access to more than one space? That, are you looking for or finding different things to celebrate in those different spaces?
I think so.
Such as?
So
you work at Belvoir.
At Belvoir, I think that there are... it comes back to a conversation about resources, but it may well be that a play that's expansive in its vision and has a decent number of people for some reason may well sit much better in a 90-seat black box than, and that the strength of a solo work may well sit much better in the larger corner stage. So it's not necessarily about, oh, let's cut the fifth character in order to make that work, or let's consider the landscape in which we want to put the story before.
What's driving that?
Yeah, I don't think that's people. I don't mean people arbitrarily telling playwrights they can't have.
No,
but I think they're starting to make those decisions.
Yeah, but it's. But I think it can inform where playwrights start their journey and think, well, I've got to write it big or write it small or write it for a particular environment. And I think the conversation about the corner is really interesting because I think the experience of playwrights going to Griffin and Belvoir and the Fairfax means that the envisioning of, which is why we end up with Miller filling the Cross Arch before we end up with New Australian plays filling the Cross Arch in the same kind of way, because potentially that's all that new playwrights are seeing, their work, the context in which playwrights are seeing similar work happen. And so I think potentially we end up going up, you know, when those new plays happen at the drama theatre or whatever it might be, there's a incongruity or something because people aren't experiencing plays in those spaces.
So step away from the practicalities and the economics for a second and talk about the vision and the poetry and the imagination and the artistic landscape of the work. What, if we're talking about Belvoir, apologies that this has got very Sydney-centric and I want to expand it out to the national, but what are the things that we typically find work beautifully downstairs and upstairs at Belvoir? And then let's talk about some other theatres as well.
I shouldn't necessarily be the person to answer that.
What did Tommy say about upstairs?
Yeah, so Tommy Murphy, who was due to be on this panel, was unavailable because he has a screening of his film Holding the Man, which many
people started in a very small corner space.
Indeed.
and didn't work when it was in London, interestingly enough. anyway, I'll follow the discussion.
So Tommy and I were talking, and we were thinking that that Belvoir downstairs, which is, for those people who haven't been there, a quite wide, thin black box with audience kind of on three
essentially
sides.
Essentially on three sides, yeah.
But where the two sides are very short. We were thinking that plays about domesticity tend to work extraordinarily well down there. Plays concerned with the intimate human condition work very well. And upstairs, those plays often feel quite drowned, and they flail in some way. And Tommy particularly felt that multi-location plays work incredibly well in the bigness of the upstairs space, which isn't actually, on a global sense, that big a space. And that big ideas plays resonate remarkably well upstairs at Belvoir. And I have a feeling that's something to do with the relationship between the audience and the stage, as well as the shape of the auditorium, that there's a space where those ideas can hang above your head in Belvoir to kind of percolate through. Yeah, please.
Well, I start off as a theatre designer, so... But I'm a writer, and so I'm very conscious of spaces when I write. And so in fact, because I live in Alice Springs, we have a big 500-seat theatre, we can fly stuff in, and sometimes that totally dictates the language that I use. But there's also another language which I love, and that's when there's no space at all used, which as a writer means practically, I think, giving it no location, giving it no stage directions. So giving the theatre director lots of room to squirm, John, rather than, and the designer, and those plays where there is no space, and it's all in the language, and things happen, you know, in the play. It's not like, I'm not talking about pure Beckett sort of, not that I'm qualified to talk about Beckett or anything like that, but, that lack of space, lack of direction, is a freedom too, which is a huge freedom, which can then create, you know, imaginary spaces for everyone to work in and work through. You know, so.
Hi. In a room full of playwrights, I'm thinking, how interested I'd be to know the kind of plays that you all choose to write. How would it be different if money was no object, your space was no object, in terms of the themes that you take on? I realise I don't expect you all to answer the question, but I am just wondering, how would Australian drama be different if everyone does?
I just have one question, which is, you know, like domestic as opposed to big ideas, or the idea that a small space necessarily means that ideas are small. There's just that kind of assumption, which I don't think that is borne out.
I think that's poor definition on the question as part.
Yeah, no, it's just.
But I think a lot of contemporary theatre is actually subverting space at the moment, like everywhere. Like people are doing contemporary dance works with full companies in tiny spaces and hanging from light globes in, you know, big space. You know what I'm saying? I think we're actually throwing it around an awful lot. In terms of where we're, you know, where works are being created, how they're being created, and how the space is being used by writers, and writers are going with that journey. Like, I feel like this is sort of really almost like talking about, you know, 10, 15 years ago in terms of some of those spaces. I think everybody's really subverting space. I don't know, maybe I'm wrong.
Do you think you're subverting space,
No. Maybe yes. Am I subverting space? But I think you know, I'll tie up the question of space with audience. Like, if you're thinking about a theatre, you have to think about the demographic of the audience, and that's a really important consideration I think playwrights should think about. I got this quote from Sarah Kane, which I love. She's amazing. She was writing Blasted, and I think she really knew, well, she knew exactly what she was doing, and she knew the theatre that it was going into, I think, towards the end of the drafting process. And she said, I think that what happens in war is that suddenly, violently, without any warning whatsoever, people's lives are completely ripped to pieces. So this is about Blasted. So I literally just picked a moment in the play. I thought I'll plant a bomb and blow the whole fucking thing up. I love the idea of it as well, that you have a nice little box set in the studio theatre somewhere and you blow it up. You know, you go to the Bush Theatre and you go in and you see the set, and there's always a longing for it to blow up. So it was a joyful to do that. But what she's talking about, of course, is blowing up that set, that kind of, you know, I think I have desires sometimes to blow up sets in Belvoir and MTC and, you know, get them messy and bloody and dirty. But I think she was talking about blowing up that the perceived notions of that particular audience, that demographic.
And Luke, I just wanted to ask you, can I ask Luke a question? Because I've seen a lot of work too, and I've toured a lot of work, or been in touring work, and it always works in the space if you just imaginatively use the space. Mm. But some stages you get a bit lost on and dwarfed in. How do you find, you've toured a lot of works in critical stages.
It is interesting, and it's something that I think quite often I would have people, directors or playwrights, going, I've written this play and it's really good for touring. And it was always the least interesting conversation to have. It was absolutely the wrong place to start. And it was much more interesting to say, I've got this play and I think it's a really good idea and I'd like to see where it could go. And if that meant that it had 8 people in it or 2 people in it, it didn't really matter. Interestingly, I think in Australia we've got the opposite problem that you have, that a lot of our regional centres are 500 to 600 seat cross arch theatres. The local councils have built $10 million spaces that are bigger than any of the spaces in Sydney or Melbourne a lot of the time.
And do you have to fill them with audiences
as well? They play for one night only and on long tours, but interestingly a lot of the time we would take shows from La Mama to 800 seat Proslash Theatre.
Wow.
And the only thing that sustained that was the solidity of the idea, not the scale of it necessarily. Yeah. And a lot of the time we worked very hard with independent artists to scale up rather than scale down. But that only worked if there was a kind of strength to the initial concept, because at that point it didn't matter, you know, so the domestic drama that is crammed into La Mama, if it's well conceived and strong enough, will actually kind of bring itself to fill a 14 metre wide cross arch stage.
That also has a lot to do with a great actor. We've toured work to schools where we've had to play in halls and sometimes in little tiny classrooms, and to observe the way that an actor can blow themselves up somehow.
Absolutely.
To fill and then to bring it down and, yeah, you know, and to play to a different age group. And it's so minute, it's a temperature change, but,
yeah,
you know, that's...
Even on audience size as well, you know, there's some of those great shows you see where there was like 10 people, but those 10
that's
people
right.
were absolutely with you and willing, and,
yeah,
you know, and it can be a 500 seat, hopefully not, but, you know, but yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, the biz is showing ourselves to ourselves. And in the 19th century in my town in Melbourne, the discovery of gold had affected much. It was one of the richest cities in the world and it filled a whole stack of theatres. Mm. And people started thinking in terms of Australianising content. And so they found a use for the revolve. You could do the Melbourne Cup on it. And they had horses running around on this revolve in one of those dramas of Coppins, who was a producer at the time. So your point about money, those same theatres would do Spring in Australia and the first blooming of the wattle and amazing kind of yellowing of the stage as the blooms bloomed. And so on. They did good stuff with water and all that, but this is pre-movies and pre-the Hollywoodization of spectacle. The theatre has much that it cannot match in that regard, but if you've got a bloody revolve, well,
go for it.
Yeah, you're a mug if you don't,
yeah,
perhaps.
It came up in the Women in Theatre discussion yesterday about where writers sit in the power base, and how do writers gain control of that? I mean, what does it feel like when you see your work in a space it shouldn't be in, which we know it can kill it? There's been several examples in Sydney this week. How do writers feel about that, about
and control that you have. And
you might have to take a couple of answers to that and then wrap it up.
That's kind of the point that I was trying to make before when I was talking, was about exactly that, you know, setting up the scene and when you're writing to make sure that if someone does go produce it or whatnot, they've got all the information to recreate the story that you wanted to tell. And it doesn't become ambiguous so that you yourself as a writer don't actually recognize the content that's being put
out. Would you direct it though?
I'm a writer direct, so I would like to direct it, but at the same time is, yes, control, at the same time is, I've learned to step away from things. Sometimes you do have to hand over, but you've got to make sure that you hand over something that is concrete, as you were saying before, to make sure that there is no misinterpretation as to your intent, because if you're obviously writing with an idea and a meaning, Arthur Miller was used as an example. If he didn't put so much stuff in there, we wouldn't be reading his plays up until today, because he's planted things in there, and his ideas have obviously stood the test of time. That's my personal opinion.
Because I mess with Miller. To his benefit, yeah. You know.
Nobody messes with Miller. So the, it's really talking about the the idea of collaboration. I mean, I agree with you. Sorry, and I'm not a playwright. Or I used to be. It seems to me that, you know, writers' intention is really important, and the gig that directors and designers are doing are to intensify that intention so that it becomes either clear intellectually or emotionally, so that what you get on stage is an expression of what it is that the playwright wants, but in a form not necessarily that they expect. And I mean, the hard part is whether or not you as a writer are holding so much onto your concept of what the play is that what is supplied to you feels awful because it's not what you thought it was, but, you know, as far as the audience is concerned, they're vastly more interested.
That's part of the collaborative process.
Yeah, sorry,
so
I'm not making that clear.
You're only one part of the whole that makes up the theatre piece. It does become an absolute collaboration.
I'm really sorry. So this will have to be the last point, because otherwise we'll never run into
that. I do question.
Sorry, I'm afraid we're just going to have to take this last point.
Oh, sorry.
I'll say it.
I want to know because playwrights write words, I want to know about the space between the words. Is that playwriting? I have a situation where the director thinks that there's going to be something happening most of the time, and I want silence, and that silence says sometimes more than the words I've written.
Yes.
Yeah.
But is that space allowed for writers?
What a conversation to take into the coffee break. Can you just join me in your appreciation for our panel?